And now, Mount Miller Power and Ely presents the greatest classic Christmas radio shows of all time.
Hello, Jack. Merry Christmas.
Same to you, Mary. Give me a kiss. There.
Jack, I was hoping for a white Christmas, not a wet one.
I'm Phil Beat of the Assassinated Press. I'm here to check on this rumor that Santa Claus refuses to ride this year.
That, my darling daughter, is the real spirit of Christmas.
Did you hear about the plot to overthrow Christmas?
And now, here's your host, Wyatt Cox.
And thanks again to our friends at Mount Wheeler Power for making our Christmas show available again this year for the final time, perhaps. But we're going to start off going back to 1940, going back to December 18th, 1940, an episode of the Fred Allen Show as Santa Claus is on strike.
I am also available for after-dinner talk. My voice has great flexibility. Can do comedy, drama, or just simple straight lines like, here he is, Fred Allen, in person.
Thank you, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you, Jimmy, for including me in your Help Wanted ad. It was very nice.
Well, I didn't think you'd mind, Fred. People hear so little about me on the program.
Why, so little, Jimmy? Mm-hmm. Why, you positively dominate the entire end of the show. Why, when everyone else is through, you always say, isolated like, this is Jimmy Wallington.
Yes, I know, but if it's a good show, people are laughing, so nobody hears it.
And, if it's a bad show?
Well, my name is the last thing people hear. I get the blame for it.
Well, in other words, you feel that while you have played no part in laying the egg, you are left to cackle over it. Well, you've got something there. Take it up with me later in the feed and grain store, where I'm going directly after to peddle tonight's... Oh, hello, Kenny.
Hello, F.A. Say, can I ask a favor?
Well, it all depends, Kenny. What is the favor?
Well, I gotta get away early tonight.
Oh, you mean you won't have time for your song?
Oh, I'll have time for my song, all right. It's just that I can't wait for my applause.
Oh, you want your applause before you sing?
Yes, if it's not too anticipatory.
Well... Well, say, where did you get that word?
Phil Harris gave it to me for Christmas.
Well, you left it in the stocking too long, Kenny. The sock has gone out of it. But about this applause business, the audience won't applaud, naturally, unless you sing your song.
Oh, but the people don't applaud my whole song, F.A., just the last note.
Say, I never thought of that. Well, if you've got to get away later, Kenny, and won't have time to wait, why don't you just sing your last note now and get your applause while you still have time?
Say, that's a great idea.
Mr. Goodman, will you and the orchestra join Kenny in the last note of his first song? All right, Kenny. Thank you. You might get a job as vocalist on a spot announcement through this little thing. And on that music... on that musical promissory note, which leaves Kenny owing us all a song, we turn to the latest news of the week. The Texaco News presents its highlight from the world of news. New York City, New York. Columbia University holds conference on education for gifted children. At a meeting held last Friday, a group of young men and women, whom psychologists had hailed as child geniuses 20 years ago, appeared to tell what had happened to their genius status in later life. Tonight, Texaco News investigates the case histories of several other brilliant ex-children who will tell their stories here this evening. But first... We present an authority on child genius, Professor Midas Tate. Now, where do you teach, Professor?
I am Professor of Applied Child Psychology at the Weehawken Day School for Abnormal Junior Intellects.
And what are your... The fact that the person is in Weehawken means that the person has an abnormal intellect. Well, what are your duties around the school besides sweeping up, Professor?
I pick out the kid geniuses.
You select the geniuses? Well, with so many children going to school, how can you tell a genius?
It's easy. I look only for kids with big heads.
Oh, you mean that any child with a big head...
is a genius.
Well, tell me, Professor, when you find a child genius, what do?
I segregate him.
Oh.
Put him in a special class with other geniuses.
Well, why?
Well, you can't leave a genius in with a class of dope kids. It's dangerous.
Well, how do you mean?
Why, the kid genius starts smartening up them dope kids. Contamination sets in. All them dope kids will grow up smart.
And you don't think that everyone should be smart?
Nah, you gotta have dopes. Who's gonna buy sweepstake tickets? Who's gonna borrow money from loan sharks? Who's gonna bet on horse races? You gotta have dopes. Dopes is the backbone of the human race.
In your opinion, Professor, when you find a genius...
you should segregate him. Otherwise, he'll contaminate somebody.
Well, thank you very much.
Hey, you got a big head, brother. But on you, it looks good.
Would you say that I was a genius, Professor?
You're a dope if I ever seen one.
Well, you picked up a following all of a sudden, I noticed. Get away from here before you contaminate me. And thank you, Professor Midas Tate. A young lady who was the talk of the Lower East Side as a child is Miss Stephanie Gittleman. You are a genius, Stephanie.
If Stephanie Gittleman is a genius, it is not for me to say. That is for you to say.
You've got a Miss Lennis in the throat. You will have to admit that you were an exceptional youngster.
At 5 years old, I am already going to high school.
Well, you were 5 years old. Were you sighted as a child?
Sighted, he says. At 6 years old, I am not only sighted, I am nearsighted.
Really?
At 7 years old, I am already wearing bivogals.
Bivogals. But despite your bivogals, Stephanie, your academic progress was rapid. When did you finish college?
At 9, I am graduating Bryn Morris.
Bryn Morris. A very popular school. Bryn is running the Morris plant on the side, I understand. Well, tell me, at Bryn Morris, were you a sorority member?
Phi Beta Kaplan.
Well, tell me, Stephanie, what have you been doing since you left college?
Confidential and nothing.
You can't get a job?
Who wants a genius?
Well, of course.
A girl to get a job today has got to be a hachitachi.
Yes, if a girl is good-looking, she doesn't need any education.
She could even be a maroon.
I see.
Well, some girls has got oomph. I got the high IQ.
But you're not bad-looking, Stephanie.
This I know, but I am wearing bivogals.
Yes, but...
There is an old saying, a girl with bivogals is not catching moguls.
Say, that rhymes.
I could help it. I'm a genius.
Yes.
I'm always rhyming.
Well, what are some of your rhymings, Stephanie?
Mostly I'm rhyming mythology.
Mythology, the Greek god?
Exactly. Vulcan, Vulcan, why are you sulking? Hercules, are you a tease?
Yes, he was.
Heighty, tighty, Aphrodite.
Very good.
But the best rhyming, I'm rhyming about my personal predicament.
Well, what is your poem called?
What to do with a high IQ.
What to do? Well, could you recite it, Stephanie?
Why not?
Well, fine. Go right ahead.
What to do with a high IQ? You are asking me, I am telling you. The Eskimo in his cold igloo. The monkey jumping around in the zoo. They are happier than me, and I'm in who's who. What to do with a high IQ?
Well, thank you very
much. What to do with a high IQ? It will get you meat at the barbecue. It will help you pay off an IOU. It will get you a chance to pitch some vool. I'm laughing and it's on you. I am saying PU to a high IQ.
There's only one thing about these people come to the microphone with things in their throats. The croup theater. You can't trust them. A new branch we're opening up. Another scintillating tyke, who astounded psychologists at an early age, is LaRue Dink. You were a child genius too, LaRue?
Oh, yeah. As a kid, I had a head like a squash.
But you were intelligent.
I was so bright you could read by me.
I mean, if you could read.
Yeah.
Well, really?
Yeah, I used to give off a kind of a dull glow.
Well, when you got a glow, you got a glow. You were luminous.
Could I help it? I was a genius.
Well, now, what studies did you excel in, LaRue?
Well, when I was 5, I was majoring in ichthyology, ipsychology, and speaking 9 languages.
You don't say.
Yeah, there was only one thing. I never was no good at arithmetic.
What a pity.
Yeah, you could say to me, veni, vidi, vici in Latin. I'd give you a civil answer.
Such as?
Probatum est.
Well, that's fair enough. Yeah. I mean, at your age, if you want
to... You could say to me, comment allez-vous, LaRue, in French.
And you'd answer?
I'd peek around the edge of my baby buggy and say, je suis in the pink, et vous?
Remarkable.
Yeah, yeah, but if you said to me, LaRue, how much is 2 and 2? I was sunk.
You couldn't compute?
I'm a genius, but I ain't no good at arithmetic. If I'd have been born a halfwit, I'd have been better off.
Well, what are you doing today?
I'm doing 20 years. Yeah, the warden let me out just for tonight.
You, LaRue Dink, a child prodigy, ended up in jail?
Yeah, it was me old nemesis.
How do you mean?
Well, I've been working as a teller in a bank.
Yes?
Last month, I'm $20,000 short.
Proving?
I still ain't no good at arithmetic.
Condolences and thank you. Young boy, what is your name again, Spratt?
Kenny Baker.
Were you a child genius, Mr. Baker?
No, and I ain't any too bright today, it says here.
What brings you to our microphone at this time, Mr. Baker?
I'm about to sing a song.
And the name of the song is?
Meanie.
Meanie. Well, let's mow, Mr. Goodman. Sung by our frustrated tenor, Kenny Baker.
Now, wait a minute, Fred. Kenny Baker's a big success. What do you mean he's frustrated?
Well, Kenny is a success as a singer, Larry. I'm speaking of his thwarted ambition. You know, as a boy, Kenny wanted to be a locomotive engineer.
Oh, no kidding, Fred.
No kidding, Larry. Underneath Kenny's neat pompadour there, he carries a mental picture of himself roaring along at 90 miles an hour with his hand on the throttle, highball Baker of the eastbound mail. You know, if a railroad made Kenny an offer tonight, he'd get his oil can and leave us like a shot.
Yes, I guess we've all had boyhood ambitions like that, Fred. You know, we've all wanted to be engineers or racing drivers or airplane pilots. Anything where we could control power and speed.
And then we grow up and get some drab little job like selling ribbons or telling jokes on the radio. And the thrill we dream of never comes.
Well, I wouldn't say so, Fred. We still can get that thrill when we drive a high-spirited, nimble, modern car. It's fun to take that wheel and put your foot down on more power than you ever knew.
Maestro, cut it out now. We got to pick up 15 seconds here. Now, let's all pull together. Maestro Goodman and his ferry boat Philharmonic have just played All the Things You Are from Very Warm for May. And now, ladies and gentlemen... Oh, there are more people in radio on the wrong side of doors. I don't know. Come in.
Mr. Allen?
Yes?
I want to warn you, Mr. Allen.
Warn me about what?
Don't you dare molest Mr. Benny while he's in New York.
Well, who are you?
I am Killer Hogan, Mr. Benny's bodyguard.
you've got a part-time job. What do you want around here?
I warn you. I warn you, if you come near Mr. Benny, it'll be fatal.
Fatal to whom?
To me. I'll drop dead for that.
Benny's bodyguard. He borrows the bouncer from some tea shop that's in receivership and tries to throw a scare into... Oh, hello, Portland.
Hello. Who was that man?
That man just went out. Well, he's supposed to be Benny's bodyguard. What Benny wants with a bodyguard? He's got as much body as a glass of elderberry wine.
Sunday.
Yes, I heard him. My jokes get better laughs on his program than they do on mine.
Are you both telling the same jokes now?
Apparently. The only difference is that I seem to be telling them first. It's I audition them for him, I guess, if they're any good.
Well, Jack said you were cheap.
Cheap? Uh-huh. Now, look, Portland. The Lipton Tea Company has been in business almost 100 years. And in all that time, the Lipton Tea Company has only had one person ever mail in a tea bag for a refill. And that person is the man who deigns to call me cheap. And if Benny's stenographer didn't get that joke, she can call up and I'll tell it over again.
Oh, I don't think Jack's that cheap.
Look, do you know why Benny is sway-backed and his eyes are bad?
Why?
Well, you know that little light that's always on inside of a Frigidaire?
Yes.
Well, Benny can't bear to think of that little light going to waste. So he crawls inside of his icebox to read. Any night that you are in Benny's house and you see him put on his overcoat, his coonskin hat, and his mittens, and then pick up the evening paper, he's off to the icebox to read.
Gosh.
Well, he generally wets his right mitten before he gets in to turn over the pages of the paper. This wet flap he has on the end of his sleeve. Why, Benny's eyes are so bad at the premiere of Love Thy Neighbor last night, he had to ask people how he was doing. He repented later, but I...
Well, how was the picture?
Well, it's a one-man picture. Rochester does it again. But Mary Martin is swell. And Benny plays himself in the picture. He's badly miscast.
Gosh, it's funny, you and Jack in a picture.
That's what you think. And now I have a surprise for you and our audience, Portland. Our guest tonight is the person who is responsible for the feud, the picture, and the whole mess. He's the little boy who first played the bee on our program, and here he is, Master Stuart Canin. Good evening, Stuart.
Good evening, Mr. Allen.
Well, you've changed quite a bit since I saw you last, Stuart. How old are you now?
14.
Say, even your voice has changed, hasn't it? Stuart, when you played the bee on our program some years ago, you didn't know what you were starting, did you?
No, Mr. Allen.
You still play the violin?
Yes, I do.
Silly question when you've got it with you. I mean, I knew it wasn't ornamental that you... Well, the grisly repercussions of your last appearance with me didn't cause you to renounce the Stradivarius and abandon your symphonic aspirations.
No, Mr. Allen. I'm quite in earnest about becoming a concert violinist.
Would you play in public at all, Stuart?
Yes, I'm concertmaster of our high school orchestra, and they also play in the orchestra at the Henry Street Settlement Music School.
Well, good for you. You're still studying, of course.
Yes, Mr. Allen. I spend 3 to 4 hours every day practicing.
Well, that's fine. 4 years ago, your playing made Major Bowes bait out of Benny. What would it do to him today?
Oh, I don't think Mr. Benny is such a bad violinist, Mr. Allen.
Oh, come, 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 Stuart. You don't have to show any professional courtesy around here. Now, you know perfectly well when Benny starts to saw on that melody sarcophagus of his. It sounds like a she-wildcat defending her young. Benny, a violin player, Stuart, after all. He's been playing the violin 30 years and still has trouble getting it out of the case.
But after all, Mr. Benny's a brother musician, Mr. Allen.
Well, of course, if you insist on being loyal, Stuart. Say, tell me, has anything exciting happened to you in the last 4 years?
No, nothing special. But then 4 years isn't such a long time.
No, Stuart, 4 years isn't a long time. Unless you're a Republican. Have you been on the radio since that first appearance of yours?
Yes, I appeared on the summer show with Harry Von Zell, and another time I won a contest for young violinists and played on a program with Jeanette MacDonald.
Why, as radio goes, you're practically Rubinoff in short pants. Well, when you realize, Stuart, that through getting mixed up with Benny and me, you became the innocent instigator of many embarrassing and far-flung events, don't you feel a little guilty sometimes?
How do you mean, Mr. Allen?
Well, look, Stuart. Now, you came on our program 4 years ago, and you played the B on your little violin. Now, you didn't mean any harm. You were just a small boy trying to get along in E-flat. So what happens? I make a casual remark to the effect that a certain party could never play the B. He replies that he can. Bad jokes begin to clutter the air. Sponsors are paying a fortune for radio time so the gags can be told. Finally, Benny plays the B, sets the violin back 400 years... But does the feud end there? No, sir. It keeps going till Paramount Pictures gets wind of it. They fetch Benny and me out to Hollywood to make a movie. Millions of dollars have been spent. Hundreds of people have worked their heads off. And the whole nation has been in a state of flux for 4 years. Now, all this has happened, Stuart Canin, because in December 1936, you tucked a fiddle under your little chin and played a piece called The Bee. Now, how do you feel?
Gosh, it's a wonder I haven't been arrested.
Hey, as long as Benny and I are still loose, you don't have to worry. But before you go, you're going to play something for us, aren't you?
Yes, I'd like to.
What piece have you selected?
Well, I'm kind of scared to tell you, Mr. Allen.
Don't tell me it's the eBay.
Yes, it is.
Well, all right. Ladies and gentlemen, Stuart Canin will now complete the cycle he began 4 years ago by playing Schubert's The Bee.
Stuart, it's been nice of you to stop in tonight. I'm glad you're growing up such a fine boy. Now, Mr. Benny and I owe a lot to you for starting our feud, and we want to do something for you in return, Stuart. Now, you want to become a concert violinist, and to further your symphonic ambitions, Mr. Benny and I herewith present you with a check for $1,000. That is yours. We have spoken to your mother, and she understands that this money is to be used to advance your musical career. And, Stuart, Mr. Benny and I both hope that you will one day become a famous master of the violin.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. And I want to thank Mr. Benny, too, for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to work hard, and I hope that someday you and Mr. Benny will be proud of me.
Well, I know we will, Stuart. Thank you. Good luck. And thanks a lot. Good night. Thank you. And now, ladies and gentlemen, two important announcements. You have only 5 more shopping days before Christmas. You have only 3 more stopping days before winter.
Well, what do you mean, Fred? 3 more stopping days?
Why, Jimmy, your ignorance is becoming noticeable. Winter officially starts this coming Saturday. So you have only 3 more days to stop in at a Texaco dealer for winter protection.
Oh, no, Fred. There's not that much time.
Well, Jimmy, I'm no Einstein, but my arithmetic isn't that bad. Now, this is the 18th, isn't it?
That's right.
Saturday is the 21st. 18 from 21.
Oh, I know, Fred. It's true that Old Man Winter puts in his official appearance this Saturday, but it doesn't mean you have 3 more days.
We'll get back to the Fred Allen Show and Santa Claus going on strike. We'll hear about that shortly. But first, these important words. Look at news around the world on this Christmas Eve as Mount Wheeler Power brings you the greatest radio shows of all time. Hang in there.
Greetings, this is Bill Ritchie, Operations Manager at Mount Wheeler Power. As the holiday season unfolds, I ask that you take a moment to acknowledge the hardworking linemen of Mount Wheeler Power among your blessings. When an outage throws a wrench into your plans, our dedicated team of linemen are there to respond. They work tirelessly, day and night, in the most challenging weather conditions to restore your service swiftly and safely. These remarkable individuals are your neighbors, friends, and perhaps even family members who brave extreme conditions to ensure reliable comfort and convenience for you. Our team of linemen embodies a collective 264 years of expertise and experience, which they put to use every single day, standing by 24/7, 365 days a year to serve our communities. Being an electrical lineman requires a unique set of traits. And we are proud to say that we have managed to gather the best of the best over the years. Their dedication to the cooperative principles that we uphold at Mount Wheeler Power is commendable. So as we sit in the comfort of our warm homes, enjoying such luxuries as these timeless radio shows brought to you by Mount Wheeler Power, let's spare a thought for these unsung heroes.
Now back to those great old shows with Wyatt Cox.
And now we return to the Fred Allen Show, going back 83 years to December 18th, 1940.
Old Man Winter is likely to strike at any...
What? Say, what is the matter with Kenny this evening? He hasn't played with his yo-yo all night long. He's just been sitting over in the corner pouting.
Well, Kenny feels pretty bad, Mr. Allen.
Is colic again, or is rickets back, are they?
No, it's Dennis Day. Kenny and Dennis aren't speaking anymore. Kenny's all upset.
Kenny and Dennis had a fight? What happened?
Well, Kenny took Dennis Day out Monday to show him New York.
Yeah?
And 2 policemen brought Dennis home at 4:30 in the morning.
Plastered?
No, deserted. Kenny left Dennis in the Statue of Liberty.
He left him in the statue? What brought that on?
I, Goodman, to this subject can add...
Mr. Goodman, you know something about LaFaire Dennis Kenny?
I know that poor Dennis Day all night was trying to get out of the Statue of Liberty. Such screaming. From 2 miles away, I could hear him.
Well, how could you hear someone yelling in the Statue of Liberty at midnight? Where were you?
I was playing pinochle with my brother-in-law on Ellis Island.
What is your brother-in-law doing on Ellis Island, Mr. Goodman?
He's there on business. The government is consulting my brother-in-law.
Consulting him on what?
Who knows? Import, export, deport.
Now, look, keep your brother-in-law out of this.
He should worry. They're keeping him out all over.
Quiet, please. Now, I'm trying to find out what happened between Kenny and Dennis. Why, formerly, they were as close as 2 fat jitterbugs in a revolving door.
Quiet, Mr. Allen. Here comes Kenny.
Oh, I...
Mr. Benny, Mr. Allen.
Wait a minute. Who are you working for? Now, remember where to go for your salary Saturday. Now, I'll admit I'm shrinking up. I'm beginning to look like Benny, but I didn't think I was that bad. But the name is Alan, Kenny.
Well,
yes, Kenny.
Mr. Alan.
Yes.
Is it time for my number yet?
Well, what's this I hear about you and Dennis Day?
Oh, it's nothing. I'm just disillusioned, that's all.
Oh, Kenny, don't tell me your faith in humanity has been shattered.
Well, humanity's all right. It's the people in it.
You mean, meaning Dennis Day?
I'm not mentioning any names, but I will say that a certain party is a notorious cheapskate.
You mean Dennis is frugal?
Frugal? Brother, he's tighter than the hips of a sailor's pants. The only thing big about that guy's his draft number.
Why did you leave Dennis and the Statue of Liberty, Kenny?
I'll tell you why. I took him all over New York.
Yeah.
We painted the town red. I paid for everything, and he leaves me holding the bag for $2.45.
That's painting the town red?
It sure is.
With borscht, I could do better.
Now, quiet, Mr. Goodman. We are not discussing interior decorating.
Borscht is good even in conversation.
I'll grant you
that. I look well in borscht.
You look well in anything you eat. Now, your vest right now will go 200 calories. But we are trying to settle Kenny's problem here.
Nobody's jipping me out of $2.45.
But, Kenny, maybe Dennis was broke.
I happen to know, Porty, that Dennis has got 18 bucks socked away in three California banks. And that lump in his left stocking ain't a sunken mump either.
Now, look, Kenny, all we want to know is why... Abandon these recriminations. All we want to know is why you left Dennis in the Statue of Liberty. Now, just what happened?
Well, right after we landed on Bedlam's Island...
Yeah.
I brought up the subject of money.
You after you laid out the 245, you hinted, did you?
Kinda.
Uh-huh.
When we started climbing up into the statue, I says, gee, two guys can see New York together pretty cheap, huh, Dennis? So Dennis says, not as cheap as I'm seeing it.
He didn't take the hint, huh?
No.
Gee.
Then as we were climbing up the shoulder of the statue, I says, Dennis, wouldn't it be a beautiful world if everybody shared and shared alike?
What did he say to that?
He says, don't pull that radical stuff on me.
I once knew a radical.
A fifth columnist?
No, a second violinist.
Now, Mr. Goodman.
What happened next, Kenny?
Well, we finally got up to the Statue of Liberty and up to the top, and we were in the Little Finger, bending out, looking at the ocean.
And you hinted again?
Yes. I said, look, Dennis, right over there is Ellis Island. That's for people who come across.
Come across. Well, did he finally catch on?
Not that guy. He said, nobody in my family has come across since the Mayflower. Brother, that's when I scrammed.
What are you going to do about the money, Kenny?
I'm sending the little miser this itemized bill. A lawyer told me he has to pay his share.
What lawyer?
I don't know his name. I met him outside the Goodwill Court.
Oh. Well, let me look at that bill you've made out there. What's this first item? Good humors, 20 cents. Merry-go-round, 10 cents. Only one of you rode?
Yes, Dennis went on a giraffe. I ran around with him.
Oh. You get the breeze, and it's healthy, too. Well, what is this next item? Minsky's, 35 cents.
I went in. It was my turn.
Oh. And, Dennis waited outside, huh?
Yes. I told him the story of the play when I came out. It was all about a bubble.
The whole story about a bubble. Now, let me see what else have we got here. Grant's Tomb, the Aquarium. Say, Kenny, what's this here? Bridge, $1. You had some dental work done?
No, that's the Brooklyn Bridge.
Well, that isn't a toll bridge. What's this dollar?
We bought it.
You bought the Brooklyn Bridge for a dollar?
It was Dennis's fault. If we'd have held out, we could have had it for 75 cents.
Kenny, don't you know that selling the Brooklyn Bridge to yokels is the oldest swindle in New York?
Yeah? Gee, no wonder that guy wouldn't give me a receipt.
Oh, you've got to be careful sightseeing around New York City.
Are there still men who go around selling the Brooklyn Bridge to innocent people?
What do you think my brother-in-law is being deported for? Whistling on Sunday?
It could be for just being your brother-in-law. Not waiting long enough for the second part of that line. Now look, Kenny, why don't you forget the $2.45 and write down, write Dennis a note. Just tell him you're sorry you left him in the Statue of Liberty.
Do you think I should?
Oh, why, certainly. After all, you had a good time with Dennis.
Go ahead and dictate a note, Kenny.
Sure.
I'll write it down for you.
Okay. Dear D.D.
D.D.?
That's Dennis Day. It's also a dirty double crosser.
Now, wait a minute. Your friends.
That's right. I forgot.
Yes. Now, go ahead with your letter, Kenny.
I'm awful sorry about leaving you in the finger of the Statue of Liberty.
Now, that's good. That's nice.
I just want to tell you, Dennis, that I had a swell time while you're here in New York. I don't think about the $2.45 anymore, except when I'm awake.
Well, that makes me feel better. Now, go ahead, Kenny.
I've got bad news for you, Dennis. Mr. Allen just told me we were swindled when we bought the Brooklyn Bridge. We don't own it at all.
Go on, Kenny.
But don't worry, Dennis. The next time you come to New York, you can ride all over town on the new 6th Avenue subway absolutely free.
But you can't ride free on the subway, Kenny. It costs a nickel.
Not for the owner, it doesn't.
You bought the 6th Avenue subway?
I snapped it up Saturday night, just before it opened.
Just before?
The man didn't think it was going to work, so he sold it to me cheap.
I give up. And now, ladies and gentlemen, for the first time in the history of radio, the president of a great subway system steps up to the microphone and sings Dream Valley.
Sound and fury, with all the sound and fury over the picture Love Thy Neighbor, there remains one little man whose contribution has gone unrecognized until now. He's Mr. Seymour Undertow. Now, just what was it you did in Love Thy Neighbor, Seymour?
Me? I sunk.
You sunk where?
In that motorboat sequence in the picture. You know, the director wanted some background atmosphere.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
A guy fishing, a couple of kids wading, another guy drowning.
Oh, and you were cast for the drowning man?
Yeah, they're shooting the scene. I'm out there in the water splashing and struggling. The director yelled, drown. Down I go. Boy, what a performance.
Well, I don't remember seeing you in the picture.
Oh, you didn't? Didn't you notice that little white cap off of the starboard bow of the monopole?
That white cap was you?
Yeah, they said I didn't put enough life in my dying. They cut out everything but the splash.
Well, that's Hollywood for you, Mr. Undertow. If a scene isn't full of life, it's a dud. As that renowned M.D., master of duds, James Wallington often puts it.
Hollywood motion picture directors know the value of action. Before a film is released, it goes to the cutting room where slow-moving scenes, the duds in the picture, are taken out. And in a way, that's how Texaco gives you all action with its famous Fire Chief gasoline. Texaco refining sees to it that slow-action elements, the useless duds of dead men...
Carol is revived about this time each year. The Texaco workshop players curtsy to tradition and repeat a Christmas fable they first presented yules ago. Tonight, Santa shows his claws in a modern tale called Santa Claus Sits Down, or Jingle Bells Shall Not Ring Tonight. Overture, maestro.
This is Station NG, NG. Good evening, friends. The makers of Magno, the magnified mousetrap for nearsighted mice, bring you the exciting quiz program, Double or Leave It.
Attention, please. We interrupt the exciting quiz program, Double or Leave It, to bring you a bulletin from the Assassinated News Service.
Flash! Santa Claus will not ride this Christmas. In a terse bulletin issued from his North Pole igloo today, Santa Claus says, quote, I am on a sit-down strike. I refuse to ride this Christmas, unquote. Rumors flood the country. A report from Dallas, Texas says...
200 families living in trailers stop building chimneys. Do not expect Santa Claus.
At Rutland, Vermont, a little girl says...
I wrote Santa Claus a letter and got no answer. He ain't coming.
At Detroit, Michigan, a labor official says...
Santa Claus better ride, or the Teamsters Union will pull out every reindeer from here to Juneau, Alaska.
At New York City, 200,000 children hold mass meeting. Tiny spokesman says...
Santa Claus can't let us down. 200,000 American children have appointed me their spokesman. I'm off to see Santa Claus now. James, my scooter.
Well, come in, little boy. What are you doing way up here at the North Pole?
this Santa Claus's igloo, ma'am?
Yes, sonny, I'm Mrs. Claus. Who are you?
Oh, I'm Buddy Jones.
Are you lost, son?
Oh, no, ma'am. I'm here to see why Santa Claus refuses to ride this year.
Well, I'm glad you've come, son. I've been arguing with the old Thumpfoot all week. He refuses to budge.
Oh, where's Santa Claus now?
He's in the next room, sulking.
Oh, can I see Santa?
Sure, I'll get him for you, son. Hey, Santa.
Ain't no use in coaxing, Ma. No, I ain't going.
Come on out, stupid. You got company.
Yeah? Who?
I'm Buddy Jones, Santa Claus.
Well, don't mean nothing to me, Sprout.
Is this awful rumor true, Santa Claus?
Yep, I ain't riding, son.
But this is Christmas Eve, Santa. Trees are lighted. Millions of trusting children have hung up their stockings. The world is waiting for you.
Well, let it wait. I ain't riding.
But, Santa...
Oh, ain't no use, Nipper. He's stubborn.
No, I ain't not neither, stubborn, Ma. I'm just sick of being Santa Claus. The world don't appreciate nothing. Squabbling, threatening, striking, warring...
But you just can't quit, Santa. You must have a reason.
I got plenty of reasons, Sprout.
As spokesman for 200,000 kiddies, I demand a statement.
What is it you want to know, Shaver?
Why won't you ride tonight, Santa Claus?
Well, son, I'll tell you. Son, I've been Santa Claus in it since the world began. For 1,940 years, I've been bringing people presents every Christmas, trying to spread joy. My intentions has been good, but my reward has been nothing but misery. The first trouble I had was back in ancient Rome. It was Christmas Eve in the court of Nero. The emperor was playing a violin concerto.
Sounds like he's... You dare to give Nero the pheasant? We want a haughtiest Tonius.
Yay. Your Majesty is Cornius.
Cornius? You scoff at my Stradivarius?
Your music will never get Rome haughtiest.
Yay,
hey, get haughtiest. You dogs! Begone, hypocrites! Scrammius! Nero can't get haughtiest. Those dogs, I'll show them.
Ho, 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 ho.
Bodkins, what tumbles out of my chimney?
Merry Christmas, Nero. Merry Christmas.
Who art thou, Lumpkin? The chimney sweep?
I'm Santa Claus, Nero. Bearing Christmas gifts for your majesty.
Ultimus nauseum. What is it, another basket of figs from the Rome Kiwanis Club?
No, my gift is a trinket rare, Nero. So rare, it hasn't even been invented yet. Here.
Gramercy lout. What is this tiny golden box?
It's a cigarette lighter, Nero. Turn that little wheel.
Art's blood. It flames.
Merry Christmas,
it
Nero.
It flames. Roma scoffed at Nero. Nero will have his revenge.
Hey, watch that lighter, Nero. You're setting fire to them draperies.
I can't make Rome hot with my music, eh? I'll make Rome hot. Revenge!
Look out, revenge! Nero. Fire! Fire! So you see, son, if it wasn't for Santa Claus, Rome wouldn't have burned.
Gosh, that was too bad, Santa.
There I was, trying to spread good cheer, and what did I get? The first hot foot in history.
But that was 2,000 years ago, Santa Claus. You shouldn't hold a grudge that long.
Well, Nero was just prologue to my trouble, son. A few centuries later, I set out to bring a present to Napoleon and Josephine. I'll never forget that Christmas, son. Josephine was a-sitting on her chaise Davenport. Napoleon opened the door.
Josie, ma petite.
Nettie.
Voilà. I am detour on the way to Waterloo, especially, mon, to say au revoir.
Mon lover, mon nappie, weppie.
Une maman, and your nappie is away. C'est la guerre.
I will be faithful, mon nappie, weppie.
Bien. If quelques man will dare to pay court to my Josephine, I will kill him. Touché.
Your petite Josephine has no other suitors, nappie, je swear.
Bien, mon big, beefy oiseau.
I have a farewell present for you, Nappy. Wait ici.
Oh, bien, bien. Mademoiselle from any place, parlez-vous? Oh, mademoiselle from...
Oh, 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 hey. Oh, oh.
Who goes there? Who is coming through the fireplace?
Merry Christmas, Napoleon.
Sacre bleu. You've come to woo my Josephine, gigolo.
Now, hold on. Put down that truncheon there.
Voilà, cochon. Take this.
Oh,
and this.
Oh,
and this.
Oh, let out. Help.
Bien ridiance.
Your little show returns, Nephi.
Ah, with the mistletoe, you sly pussycat.
Yes, it's Christmas Eve. What can be keeping Santa Claus?
Santa, mon dieu. You are expecting the chap in the red suit?
Oui, Nephi. Don't you think Santa Claus will come?
Not tonight, Josephine.
Yes, son. Napoleon gave me a concussion that Christmas. Running out of the castle, I fell in a moat. My ermine got wet and come to life. My collar and one cuff got away.
But you can't stay mad at the world because years ago a Frenchman mushed you up, Santa Claus.
Well, things has happened since, sons. Another Christmas, I got a raw deal in a suburb of England. It was called the American Colonies. I dropped in at the house of a scapegoat named Paul Revere. The cottage had no chimney, so I looked in the window. Mrs. Revere was preparing a turkey. Paul come limping into the room.
Christmas dinner ready, Effie?
Yes, Paul. Pull up a chair.
Set my plate on the mantelpiece.
Don't you sit down yet, Paul Revere. That ride was last April.
So every Middlesex village and farm ain't once around Central Park, Effie.
Well, you ought to try and sit down for Christmas, Paul. It'd be a nice present for your spine.
Who's that?
Might be a British spy, Paul.
Hand me my gun, Effie. Who's there, Whig or Tory?
Merry Christmas, Paul Revere. It's Santa Claus.
So what?
I've got your Christmas present, Paul. It's a cushion stuffed with fuzz from Delaware peaches.
For me to set on?
You bet.
Don't let him in.
Sounds mighty tempting, Effie.
Might be some British trick, Paul.
No, I'm Santa Claus, Mrs. Revere. Open up.
I got my gun, Effie. I'll open the door a crack.
Merry Christmas!
I told you, Paul. Look at that suit.
A red coat. Take this.
Oh! Oh! Well, son, when I got back to my sleigh and sat down, I was mighty glad I still had that cushion full of Delaware peach fuzz. You see, son, the world's given old Santa plenty of trouble.
It sure has done you dirt, Santa. But nobody dare abuse Santa Claus today.
Well, here's where you're wrong, son. Only last week I was previewing a visit. I went down to a place called Washington, D.C., Well, I got mixed up and went down the wrong chimney. I come out in some office. I was going to wish the man a Merry Christmas when he yelled at me.
What are you doing here? How much money do you want?
Now, I ain't no senator. I'm Santa Claus.
Oh, yeah. The State Department's looking for you. You're through.
Through? I ain't even started.
You're washed up, Santa Claus. The government's ruled you're too slow for this job. You're a bottleneck.
Now, hold on. You fellas gummed up Thanksgiving, but you ain't monkeying around with Christmas.
Well, it's all settled, Claus. It's all settled. Turn in your sleigh and reindeer to the FBI. Here's your receipt.
Well, you can't legislate me. I'm a mythical character.
Being a friend of Wendell's won't help you.
It ain't right. After 1,940 years, you can't plow Santa Claus under. I got something to say.
Oh, a fifth columnist, huh? I'll take care of you.
Yes, Chief?
The works, Bildad.
Okay, Chief. Here's your subpoena, Fatty.
Subpoena? For what?
You're wearing a red suit, Fat.
What about it? Wearing a red suit ain't never been a crime.
It is today. Let's go.
Now, hold on, mister. Who are you?
I'm a member of the Dice Committee.
Gee, Santa, you certainly had a lot of trouble.
Well, that's why my spirit's broken, son. Being Santa Claus is just a pain in one century after the other. I'm through.
Please don't say that, Santa. Have pity on us kids. We'll have no toys.
Santa ain't a-moving, son. This is one Christmas I'm gonna enjoy in peace. What's that clock striking?
It's 12 o'clock.
It is, eh? Well...
It's Christmas Day, Santa Claus.
Don't mean nothing to me. I'm taking it easy. I'm sitting right here.
Won't you change your mind, Santa?
I ain't getting kicked around again this Christmas.
Please, Santa Claus.
Hey, Ma.
Yes, Santa.
Where's my mitten? My bag? My reindeer? My sleeve?
Santa.
Yep, I'm a-going, Ma.
I'm a Santa Claus.
I've changed my mind, son.
Oh, thank you, Santa.
Christmas ain't Christmas without Santa Claus. I'm giving the world one more chance.
Can I have a statement for all of the kiddies, Santa?
You bet you can, son. Just say, it's Merry Christmas.
Oh,
is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
From 83 years ago, December 18th, 1940, Fred Allen. And from not that long ago, this is Chuck Berry.
COC, I have no identification of unknown track number 004. I advise you to scramble.
Advise you to scramble. That phrase is heard almost daily at the North American Air Defense Command, where our business is to guard the skies over North America against possible air attack. This is Lee Mosley at NORAD headquarters in Colorado Springs, Colorado, reminding you of another service provided by NORAD. We call it NORAD Tracks Santa. I'll be furnishing exclusive reports on the journey of Santa again this Christmas Eve, and you can hear it all right here.
And stay tuned to the Nevada Talk Network and here at KELY in Ely, and we will keep you up to date on the progress of Santa all evening long. Stay tuned on this Christmas Eve as Mount Wheeler Power continues to bring you more of the greatest radio shows of all time. Thank you so much for making us a part of your Christmas Eve. News comes up next.